Good afternoon. Our speaker this afternoon is Jean-Marie Tarascon. He's in the Distinguished Lecture Series of the Environmental Energy Technologies Division. He comes to us from the University of Picardy in France, where he has also been the director of the Laboratory of Reactivity of Chemical Solids. Professor Tarascon has actually spent a lot of time in the United States. He did a postdoc at Cornell University, and after getting his PhD in Bordeaux, he worked at Bell Labs and at Bellcore, and one of the accomplishments that they had there was a plastic lithium-ion battery with a polymer electrolyte and a lithium manganese oxide spinel positive electrode. He currently is on sabbatical in Santa Barbara. He tells me that he still works actively in the laboratory. Today he's going to speak on materials for better lithium-based storage systems for a green energy society.
Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. And I want to thank John Newman and Vincent Battaglia for inviting me to give the lecture. It is a great honor for me to be in Berkeley, because believe it or not, it is my first time here. I send a lot of students. Four or five of my PhD came here as a postdoc, but I finally came to see where they were going. So what I am going to do today is try to give you a flavor of the type of work that we are doing, and lithium-based storage for a green energy society. So you are going to see to my presentations that doing research in batteries, sometimes you need to work out of the box, think out of the box, and I'm going to show you some recent advances that we have done at the material levels as well as at the electrode configuration. So in order to set up the scene, let me remind you first why we are in this business and what our motivation. Here I am showing you the repartition of the energy sources that we are using today. In order to illustrate it, that you have two types of energy. You have the non-renewable energies that are coming directly from fossil fuel, gaseous or carbonaceous materials, which account for 89% of what we have been using. And you have another class that are the renewable ones. Nowadays, we are using non-renewable energy because they are the cheapest, but unfortunately, they are the most polluting. And we all know that these fossil energy are running short. So there is a strong motivation in order to develop this renewable energy coming from the wind, the sun, and so on. But you need to realize that when you look at the electricity chain, the generation of electricity is only one issue, because you want generating the energy where people need it. You want to deliver when it is needed. And finally, you want to provide energy when it is needed. And if you want to use this kind of renewable energies coming from the wind and so on, you need to hear to talk about energy storage. So our motivation of our work is the following one. We try to develop sustainable technology for energy storage so as to manage the use of this renewable energy and to shift smoothly from fossil fuel to energy coming from the wind and so on. And also to favor the development of electric transportation for a better environment. Means in this case, we want to shift from thermal cars to electrical cars. And just I will remind you here that every time that you are burning 1 liter of gasoline, you are liberating 1.5 kilograms of CO2, which is about 750 liters. So now you have a problem in which you want to store energy and to restitute it as electricity. And the best way to do this is to use what I will call the conversion of chemical energy into electricity. Why? Because chemical energy and electricity share the same carrier that is the electrons. And when you're doing so, you use the device that we call batteries and that everyone used to complain since we are making batteries because there is not enough autonomy and so on. But you need to realize that batteries have long been around and for more than 200 years. As a matter of fact, it's nice to trace the history of battery and see more or less how this came out. And like most of the time in science, this came out from very strange observation. And the first one was Louis Galvani back to 1781, which took a frog leg. And in this case, he contact with two different metals and the muscle was contracting. He make the rapid claim, he didn't publish in Nature Materials, but the muscle produced electricity. Of course, at the time, scientists didn't like it too much, and 10 years later, I think, is Alexander Volta, which says this is completely wrong. He tried to do the experiment again, and what you observe is indeed the muscle contracted, but he associated this as a pure association of two different metals that were immersed into the same aqueous electrolyte, which in this case was the tissue muscle. And in order to demonstrate his statement, telling that what Louis Galvani was thinking was wrong, he clearly assembled, as indicated there, a stacking of zinc copper disc separated by a form in which he was introducing an electrolyte. And by doing so, he built the first coronar battery, as indicated here. And then, after, you have several developments, and I am listing a few of them here, for the two centuries, where you can see that the fuel cells, lead acid battery, nickel cadmium, you can find all what we know nowadays today. And it is important, if you want looking for application, to compare the performance of these batteries, here in terms of energy density, and watt-hour per liter, and watt-hour per kilogram. And you can see that out of this various technology, the lithium-ion one is the most promising one, and is the one that I will to talk about it today. But what is very important also when you work with the field of battery is you need to realize that sometimes research is not going very fast. And as a matter of fact, you can see 1839 was the beginning of fuel cells, and nowadays people are still telling you that the fuel cells are an emerging technology. Some happen. And also it's very interesting to look what happened. Sometimes you want to compare the field of information storage versus energy storage. And here, again, we have a huge pressure because, of course, people working in electronics are talking about the Moore law. And I try to plot here, look at the scale, our log scale, what has improvement over the last 30 years in number of junctions per sheet or in the number of megabits per inch square, as indicated here. Now I am going to put our progress on the batteries. And you are going to see we have been very slow. And of course, we have been criticized quite a long time, and we are still criticized by the newspaper. As a matter of fact, you can read very nice sentences. Advances in battery research are always restricted by chemistry. And I like this one, research in the field of batteries move at a glacier pace. So don't put too much pressure on us. Anyway, so why this does happen? Because finally, if you look at the electrochemical system, it is relatively complicated. Even so, we have five components, which are really two electrodes, an electrolyte, and two current collectors. Why is it complicated? Because number one, you use electron materials. And the electrode is not a single component, but is several components, and you need to adjust the amount of material, binder, electronic conductor. Then, you move to the field of electrolyte, and here again, the electrolyte can be liquid, it can be solid, it can be gel, it can be polymer, and so on. So here again, several options. And finally, the most difficult part of this stuff is actually the nightmare, as a matter of fact, of all the electrochemical systems. These are the interfaces. And we have about four interfaces to master. So what I am going to show you today is in order to make research advance in the field of lithium ion batteries, you need to work as a team, you need to work as a multiple with different expertises. And indeed, as you can see here, the design of better electrochemical system is going to be the result of full interaction between material scientists, electrochemists, design people, and so on. So again, our progress are going to be lying down at the cross-section of various disciplines. And you're going to see in my presentation, I will move from pure inorganic compounds, move to organic chemistry and so on, where the field, I think, is going. So, the way that I plan to give the presentation, I will, at the beginning, give you a very brief recap of the lithium-ion batteries in order to give you the technological knowledge to to follow the rest of this presentation. I will talk about the challenge, and then I will move to the beef of this presentation, what I will call the development of sustainable and greener lithium batteries, where I will show you some new ways to synthesize electrode materials, and also the way to design new or renewable organic electrodes. And finally, I will conclude by giving you my personal view on the future of the battery and on the new chemistry that may be around the corners. So let's start with the lithium-ion batteries. That is going to be the topic of this presentation. Here, I designed a schematic of this type of systems where you have two electrodes, insert and non-aqueous electrolyte. The specificity of lithium-ion batteries is that we are using lithium insertion electrodes, which means they are materials that can absorb and release lithium during the charge and the discharge. The system that you are using today is indicated here. You have lithium cobalt oxide positive electrode and a carbon negative electrode. The output voltage is about 3.6 volts, and the practical capacity is about 0.5 to 0.6 electrons per 3D metals, which means that we are calling at your phone. This is more or less what you are doing. You are charging and discharging systems. Now, the only formula that I'm going to use in this presentation is the following one, where we define our figure of merit, which is a specific capacity. We define an ampere-hour per kilogram, and you can see here the formula is relatively simple. You have two important numbers, delta X, which will be the number of holes and two insertion compounds, and M, that is going to be the molecular weight. And the rule of the game, you already understood it, is to increase delta X and to lower M. And this is more or less what people have been doing for the last 25 years. And I've been doing this stuff, of course, we try to classify all the materials and we make a list of what were all the parameters, all the figure of merit that an electrode material should have. And you can see here, high electronic conductivity, fast lithium ion diffusion, and so on. And when you establish a list like that, and when you play a game, when you have so many rules, of course, the number of candidates are relatively limited. And indeed, after 25 years of research, the three types of positive electrodes that we have are lithium cobalt oxide, lithium nickel oxide, or lithium manganese oxide. And of course, people have worked very intensively as a ternary phase diagram to come out with this kind of layer compound with a composition one-third, one-third, one-third. But whatever you are doing, you cannot exceed one electron per 3D metals. So this is very important, but because this is telling you that the lithium-ion technology will not produce indefinitely more energy density. We are limited. And we know what is our intrinsic limitation. So the question is how we do go around. And this is more or less where, back to the 2000, our team and other teams in the world have decided to add size as an extra dimension to composition and structure to try to modify the physical and electrochemical properties of materials. And by doing so, we open some new routes. Indeed, we were able to trigger completely new mechanism by what we call this conversion reaction, which in this case, we take a material, cobalt oxide, which doesn't present any vacancy at all, and you can electrochemically reduce this compound, create this kind of nanocomposites, and thanks to this nano character, now you can have reversible reaction. And you can see here, by doing so, we don't have any longer 0.6 electrons per 3D metals, but we move to about 2 electrons. So this, more or less, is a staggering gain. And more recently, using the transition from bulk to nanomaterial, we succeed in turning insulating compounds into attractive insertion materials. And I will come back on these materials, which is a lithium ion phosphate, where this material was disregarded for about 25 years and becomes the most prized material nowadays in our community, and with A123, an American company that is very successful, has been developing such type of battery. So if I look where the field is today, I will take this transparency that I borrow from Sony, where you can see that we have been evolving over the last 20 years, increasing the energy density. We can see the nice change of the step due to the arrival of nanomaterials. And nowadays, we are at this stage where we can make lithium ion system of about 200 watt-hour per kilogram and about a volumetric density of about 625 watt-hour per liter. So now the question is, how can we go further? And finally, how we can make sure that the success that lithium ion technology has so far can be implemented and can be used for electric transportation and so on. So here you are going to see that there are numerous challenges to be solved. As you can see, first, we need to increase the energy density by at least a factor of 2 as indicated here. You also need to reduce the cost by at least a factor 5 to 10 as indicated here. Then, we have a problem of safety. Indeed, some of these batteries blow up, and if we want to use electric vehicles, we need to solve the issue. And unfortunately, safety and cost are going into the opposite direction. If you want to increase safety, you are going to increase the cost of the batteries, there is no doubt about it. And finally, a very third important problem is the concept of sustainability and designing new lithium-ion batteries. Which means that, in this case, we need to build materials or to design materials or processes in which, in this case, you are going to have the lowest or the smallest environmental footprint. And this is going to be very important. Because if you look at the way the batteries are made today, you need to realize that the cycle life is as indicated here. First, you need to extract the raw materials. You need then to purify them. You need then to elaborate the materials. And when you do so, this is going to create a large amount of energy that you can translate in the amount of CO2 per kilowatt hour. Then, as the amount of batteries that you are going to produce is going to increase considerably over the next year, in the next few years, and reach about 10 million, recycling is going to be mandatory. And if you want to recycle, in this case, again, it is a very high energy demanding stems. And finally, what is important also is the raw materials, and we all know that if we keep using our batteries the way that we are doing now, we are going to run out of cobalt. So, when you look at new research, and you are going to conduct your research, you need to consider the electron materials having the lowest possible life cycle cost and the minimum environmental footprint. So, again, if we ask today to our industry and our car manufacturer to move to lithium-ion batteries, you don't want in 50 years to tell them you need to move to something else because we are running out of cobalt, we are running out of lithium and so on. So we need to think about how we are going to position ourselves in 50 years from now. So what will be the ideal situation? The ideal situation will be the following one, in which in this case, you could use directly make electrodes from materials, from natural products coming from biomass. Then you will do all the extraction, everything at room temperature using green chemistry. Everything will be awesome. Then the recycling, you are going to liberate CO2 that is going to reintegrate it and the biomass via photosynthesis. In this case, you will have a zero CO2 footprint. And this is more or less the long target that we have decided to address in our group. And I'm going to show you several directions that we are pursuing nowadays in order to reach this stage. I will recommend on 3 different points. The first one, I am going to review the way to make inorganic materials via low temperature process, eco-efficient process. And I'm going to show you here some new advances in material synthesis. Then, I will move to the possibility of using organic electrodes as a renewable insertion electrodes and showing you the capacity of making this new renewable lithium battery. And finally, I will comment on the state of the art and the work we are doing on lithium air batteries. So, in order to show you the inorganic part of this program, I will take one of the most, again, prime sample, that is this famous lithium ion phosphate. Again, this is a mineral. This has been one of the main contenders from electrochemistry since it has a nice redox potential, about 3.5 volts. But unfortunately, this material is a very poor electronic and ionic conductor. So, the question is how to use this compound that has been disregarded for about 20 years. We need to compensate for this low electronic and ionic conductivity. You all know that these properties are intrinsic to the materials. So automatically in this case, you cannot change it, you just need to act on the electrodes. So we are going to see how we can act on the electrode kinetics in order to improve these electrode materials. In this case, what we are going to do is find a way to fuel nicely the electron and the ions into this electrode. Because to do electrochemistry, you need, of course, the duality of ions and electrons at the same place. And the way to do so is really to reduce the particle size, as indicated here. In this case, the time for intercalation is going to decrease as the square law of the particle size. Which means, if you reduce the particle size by a factor 10, you are going to reduce the time of the ion to diffuse by a factor 100. This will take care of ionic migration. Now, if you need electrons, what we are going to do in this case is really take the particles and try to surround it by kind of coating, as indicated here, by putting this carbon coating. And you can see that if you go to nanoparticles and do a carbon coating, now we have access to all the ions within the particles, as indicated by the shining part of the particles. So, we are going to see in this case how we can design the materials. But what is very important to realize, even so lithium iron phosphate is a mineral, what I want to say here is that synthetic mineral has to be made at the nanoscale, and we have to look for the most expeditious and energy-saving processes to do this. And I'm going to show you the way that we have been evolving and trying to prepare these compounds, and the progress that we have made, and the innovation through this material synthesis. When we start on this problem about 6-7 years ago, the first process that we came out with was a high-temperature process, in which, in this case, we mix lithium hydrophosphate and nitrate with, in this case, some acrylonitrite monomers. We use some kind of surfactant as a stearic acid in order to prevent the particles to coalesce. And also, we use hydrogen peroxide as a polymerization inhibitor. Then, you raise the temperature, and what is happening? You start to form an amorphous solid, and then you trigger the polymerization of the acrylonitrite to get this kind of morphology. Then, you try to go to higher temperature, and under reducing atmosphere, you form lithium ion phosphate. You pyrolyze the organic polymer, which is going to leave behind some carbon molecules, and you form, as indicated here, some particles that are surrounded by carbon coating. And you can see this very nicely when you look at isolation microscopy, where you can see the layers or the iron oxide layers and surrounded at surfaces by this kind of carbon coating. So this is more or less the first way that we have been synthesizing some good lithium ion phosphate. But again, this was a high temperature. You need to go to low temperature. So we designed some new low temperature processes, what we call solvothermal processes, and which in this case, we went to the thermodynamics in order to establish the solubility pH diagrams so as to determine what are the nature of the chemicals that you are going to react and to know more specifically at which pH you should conduct your reaction. And by doing so, we are able to come out with the different components, means that we react iron sulfate with the phosphoric acid. But in this case, since you want to be at pH around 8 to 9, you are obliged to counterbalance by a base as lithium hydroxide. But if you do so, you will not precipitate lithium ion phosphate because all these calculations were done at room temperature. And we found out that to precipitate lithium ion phosphate, you are obliged to go to above 100 degrees C. And the trick and the clue of all this process was to add the dimethyl sulfoxide, which is high temperature elevator solvent, which enabled us to go to about 120 to 130 degrees C and to precipitate lithium ion phosphate. So having defined this, we then move to the kinetics, and by adjusting the concentration of the different components, by tuning also the reacting time, we were able to prepare particles, as indicated here, very homodispersed powders, having size ranging from 114 nanometer or 14 nanometer. And in this case, we could study what will be the effect of the particle size on the electrochemical performances. And we do so, we look at these particles, at this powder. First, we note that the unit cell volume was quite larger for the particles made out of 1 nanometer compared to the one of 14 nanometer. And then, if we look by mass Bauer spectroscopy, as you can see here, When the particles are 140 nanometers, we have, in this case, only ion plus 2, while there is appearance of ion plus 3 on the particles that are made out of 14 nanometers. So we try to understand the reason for this, and we have done some neutron diffraction data. And what we found is that when we move to nano-sized particles, lower or equal to 14 nanometers, we can really have some kind of cation vacancies as well as inter-site mixing. So at this point, the question was important and say, you know, what will be the effect of this kind of size difference on the electrochemical performances? In order to do so, we have performed some kind of classical electrochemical measurements in which I will plot the potential as function of the capacity. You can see that when the particles are about 140 nanometers, we get a very nice plateau, which indicates of a two-phase process, while when we have 40 nanometer particles, we have a solid solution, as indicated by this S-type shape voltage composition curve. And indeed, in order to check this point, we can perform some X-ray diffraction measurements. And this is what I am showing you here, where we are going using this type of device to monitor the change in the structure as you are going to charge and discharge your batteries. And you can see, when I am charging the batteries, the right curve here, all the peaks are moving smoothly towards the left, towards the right, which in this case, there is no discontinuity, clearly indicate that we have indeed a solid solution process. So, by doing this type of work, I am showing you that by downsizing the particle size at a nano level, we can move from a two-phase to a single-phase intercalation systems, and more so, we can really prepare lithium phosphate that you can have or you can cycle without any carbon coating. So this is more or less the type of work that we have been doing at low temperature. But if you look at this work, there are still two difficulties. The first one is the fact that we have some presence of ion plus 3. And the second one that I'm going to mention here is the fact that we are, in this chemical reaction, using a threefold excess of the costly lithium hydroxide, which in this case is going to generate the sulfate that you are going to be able to retrieve in the process. So this is more or less a costly process. So now the question is, how can we find another approach in order to bypass this large excess of lithium hydroxide? And it's here that we come out with the idea, based on the work that has been done a few years ago by Egon Matijevic, where we are going to use now an extra molecule that we are going to use, in this case, urea, which under mild temperature is going to undergo an hydrolysis reaction and is going to liberate the base that I am using or that I need in order to have the right pH. And by doing so, we can now synthesize the lithium ion phosphate without using lithium hydroxide in excess, without wasting, I would say, our precursor. But we simply use this urea, which is going to liberate two molecules of ammonia that you are going to use to neutralize the acidity of lithium ion phosphate. And by doing so, you can prepare the lithium ion phosphate, and the product is ammonium sulfate that is quite familiar and is used as a fertilizer and so on. So this is more or less a way that we have been developing the synthesis of lithium ion phosphate. And indeed, we can see nicely what is going on. Here, what I am showing you is a reaction. I am following the reaction here, where I mix all the components, I put everything in a kind of autoclave, then I raise the temperature to about 180 degrees C, and I monitor, as function of time, the pH, as well as the X-ray evolution. And what you can see, that as function of time, here, the pH is increasing, which means in this case, I am decomposing my urea, I am liberating my ammoniac molecule, so the solution is becoming basic. And at the same time, when this happens, you can see the formation of lithium and phosphate. And the advantage of this process is that now you can prepare nanoparticles and you don't have any more ion plus 3 as an impurity. And of course, if you look at the property of the materials, you can see you obtain nanoparticle powder with very nice electrochemical properties. And the process that I'm showing you here, you can generalize to a large amount of molecules, a large amount of compounds, since I am showing you what we can be doing with urea, but we can also do this with azocyanate, with hexamethyl tetramine, and so on. Also, you can use various solvents, and some of them have advantage, such as a formaldehyde, to also decompose at high temperature to generate this basic species. So we can apply this to the synthesis of large amount of materials, and we have done this, make this phosphate with either manganese, cobalt, or nickel, and we also have used these techniques to prepare lithium ion silicate. But what is important now is, I am showing you another synthesis, I reduce the operating temperature, but I still need to operate under pressure conditions, means I use an autoclave. So the next step and the next win is going to be how to bypass the isothermal conditions. So what you want to do is, more or less, you want to go from this kind of bomb to an open flask container. Means that you want to use water. Now, I want to use a low vapor pressure flux media. And of course, if you look at the field of inorganic chemistry, people have used molten salt for quite a long time. And they have been working with molten salts of sodium chloride, potassium chloride, and so on, that you need temperature about 400 or 500 degrees C to have a melting stage. And then after, when you make the compound, you need to clean up at the end of it. And now you are going to see something completely new that we come out with is the use of ionic liquids. Indeed, you have certainly heard a lot about ionic liquids, where people are working quite a lot on it for electrolyte and so on. In our case, ionic liquids, for those who don't know what they are nothing else but a molten salt, in which, in this case, they are light liquid at room temperature of 100 degrees C. And what we have done here is try to develop some inorganic synthesis and presence of ionic liquids. Why? Because ionic liquids have somewhat the same solvating properties as water, with, in addition, they are not volatile. There is no vapor pressure, which in this case, the use of autoclave is not mandatory. And we have done, and we can conduct the reaction at temperature of about 300 degrees C, which is more or less the stability of these ionic liquids. So we indeed move into the direction, and we try to synthesize our lithium ion phosphate using these ionic liquids. And indeed, we can, as you're going to see, obtain the right phase at 220 to 150 degrees C. We can obtain lithium ion phosphate with water and CO2. And when you do this, you can follow nicely. You do this stuff in open flask container, as indicated here. And in 24 hours, you can synthesize the phase. And this phase, you can also reach a stage of nanomaterials. This is a completely new approach on the field of inorganic chemistry, where now we are going to use these ionic liquids to prepare new compounds. And again, when you see how you can make ionic liquids, which are finally the right combination of anionic and cationic molecules, we are here in the field of organic chemistry, and this organic chemistry is quite rich. Indeed, you can make thousands of ionic liquids, so it means that you can, in this case, tune the property, the solvating property of the ionic liquids for the type of synthesis that you want to do. And here, I am showing you what we have been doing with this type of ionic liquid that we call EMI-TFSite for ethyl methyl imidazolium and TFSite for sulfoamide. In this case, we can really have this protonic, this proton, and these two positions, or having a methyl group. Whatever, we can get nice compound. But therefore, you can see, if you change the nature of the cation and anion, you can, in this case, prevent the obtention of the lithium phosphate. For instance, if you use a Cl- rather than TFSI minus, in this case, you won't be able to succeed in preparing lithium phosphate. The same thing, we are switching from, in this case, this pyrrolidinium versus azolium cations, you won't obtain, again, this lithium phosphate. But what you can do with ionic liquids, you can also play with the nature of the alkyl chains, as indicated here, or also with the polarity of the chain. And you can see here, what is very important, that you have a completely different orientation of intensity, I should say, of these two peaks. Which means, in this case, that you can really use ionic liquids as a structuring directing agent to orient the growth of your particles. means that you want to grow particles in the 1001 direction or vice versa, you can do it by tuning the type of ionic liquids. And as a matter of fact, I want to show you how this does happen, a very interesting process that we were able to understand via some sophisticated high-resolution electron microscopy. And what you are looking here is more or less the growing of lithium iron oxide, lithium iron phosphate particles as function of time. At the beginning, you can see the primary particles, about 100 nanometers. And then, with time, these particles aggregate to form this kind of nice filaments, which are about 1 micron length and about 200 nanometers wide. And after maturing, what is happening? Due to the surface tension between the tip of your needle chains and the size of the chain, the growing process stops, and now the particles pack to each other, side to side, like a Lego-type packing, to create these long fibers, where you can see that the width of the fiber turns out to be the length of these needles here. And this perfectly crystallized, as indicated here, where the basal plane is a 101 plane, explaining perfectly the preferential orientation that we observe in our X-ray data. And again, this process that I'm showing you here is not specific to lithium iron phosphate, where I can see here all the electrochemical performance of the materials made using the process. You can see we have a nice capacitor retention, nice power rate, but what is very important now, these materials has never saw a temperature greater than 250 degrees C. It has been ball mill with 10% of carbon. And this process has been applied to now the synthesis of a wide class of materials. This is again a compound that was previously made at high temperature, 700 degrees C. Now, using ionic liquid, we can make these materials in 48 hours at 270 degrees C with a performance indicated here. Again, there is some chemistry involved in the design of ionic liquid because in this case, the EMI TFS site wasn't working. Due to the fact that you have an acidic proton here, we are obliged to replace it by the methyl group in order to prevent the attack by the F- basis species. So this is more or less a completely new inorganic synthesis that is coming out here. Now, we can still one step further, and I'm going to show you some last data that we are on, where now we want to do this stuff at room temperature. So how can you make this material at room temperature? And you are going to see here, again, the field is going to evolve to different knowledge. What we are going to look now is, nearly, can we prepare these materials at room temperature and ambient pressure? And what we have done here, we try to look more or less what has been done, what nature has been done, and we look at the issue of biologically induced mineralization, in which, in this case, a bacterium, such as Bacillus bacterium, has been used, for instance, to prepare this calcite. Remember, I showed you before that we have been using urea as media species to generate this NH3 base. So today what we have done here is we use the same principle to synthesize lithium and phosphate. Means we use directly these components in which we put urea, and we use in this case a bacterium, the same as air, in order to trigger the hydrolysis of urea and to generate this lithium and phosphate. And what we have observed, identified by electron microscopy, that we have creating a biofilm at the surface of the bacteria in which you can find some aggregates that are related to this iron phosphate. And then, if you look at the function of time, you see that this aggregate evolves and you create this kind of needle particles that are characteristic of the lithium iron phosphate. And by this process, we were able to obtain nanofilaments of lithium iron phosphate. They were at a nanoscale so small that even they were reacting too much with air, and it was very difficult to observe them by microscopy. So this is more or less to telling you what we have been doing here. So in order to summarize this first part, I hope that I convince you that we can do great innovation in terms of material synthesis, and I show you in lithium and phosphate how we have moved from ceramic process to kind of nanomaterials by moving to low temperature, either hydrothermal, ionothermals, or even biomineralization. And what is very important, I should emphasize some of these techniques. Some of them are totally new, namely the ionothermal synthesis, where we have applied successfully this technique to the synthesis of these materials indicated here, and also of some new electrode compounds that you will certainly hear very soon. So this is more or less what we have been doing in the case of material synthesis via eco-efficiency processes. Now, I am going to move to the second part of the presentation, in which I am going to show you how we can move from inorganic compounds to organic electrodes in order to develop these greener and sustainable lithium-ion batteries. And here again, people have been familiar with the field of organic chemistry. They will tell me there is nothing new in moving to organic compounds. And they will indeed be right, since I should confess that Alan Iger got a Nobel Prize for his polymeric conductor, and the first lithium-ion batteries was based on a polyaniline, means a polymer conductor. But what we are going to bring different? Our wish here is really to try to use organic molecules that are going to prepare to the principle of green chemistry and that are going to be active with respect to lithium insertion. In this case, the people were talking about dopants. Here we are talking about lithium insertion into an organic framework. So in order to do so, we didn't move completely like crazy from the field of inorganic to the field of organic electrodes, but we stopped by some hybrid electron materials. And we, as a matter of fact, look at a family of compounds that was quite interesting, as we call this metal organic framework. And you're going to see what we have been doing here. What are these metal organic frameworks? I am sure people and the audience know some of these compounds, since they have been very useful for CO2 absorption and so on. These are type kind of hybrid materials in which you have these kind of inorganic iron oxide chains, which are linked by these benzene dicarboxylate molecules to form this kind of one-dimensional diamond-shaped tunnels running parallel to the C-axis, in which you can have some kind of type of molecules, water or other type of molecules. If you look at the formulation of this compound, and if you do some very simple calculation about electronegativity, you come out that in this case, the ion is +3, which means if the ion is +3, there are some changes to be able to reduce this compound electrochemically. Even so, this material is insulating, as I mentioned previously. So, we look at the performance of the materials, and here I plot the potential versus the composition, and indeed, we found that this compound is able to uptake and to release some type of lithium reversibly, as indicated here. And this can be done as relatively decent rate, as indicated here, and we have, in this case, a reduction of ion +3 and ion +2, and vice versa. But however, if you talk about in terms of electrochemical performance, making electron materials, no way that you can make something out of this compound, since the capacity is relatively small, about 75 milliampere per gram. So at this point, the question was, how can we really trigger the chemistry of this compound, or what we can do to improve this? So we went to two different types of approaches. The first one was relatively simple. Can we really use these linkers and really functionalize these linkers to have some active redox center for electrochemistry? You know what? We replace this kind of terephthalic acid by this kind of hydroquinone-based ligands, which have some active center. When we do so, we were not enough luck, since we don't obtain any improvement, for the simple reason that there is no electron transfer between the inorganic part and the linkers, organic linkers, or structure. So, having this was not going anywhere, we decide in this case why we don't really take the same structure, and now we try really to fill the pore of the structure with some kind of active organic molecules. In this case, we try to enter quinone into these holes. So all this work was great. We were able to synthesize a new compound, solve new structure, but when we look at the electrochemistry, what happens is during the first discharge, we were able indeed to reduce this quinolic function, but after one cycle, these quinone were not any longer be maintained as the channels and were coming out of the structure. So it means we have very small effect. So, frustrated by all this approach, we decide to directly move and to look in at simply the electrochemistry of the various linkers. And what we are looking here, we look at the terephthalic acid, and we decide to look at the lithium version of the terephthalic acid. So from organic chemistry, it's a very simple acid-based reaction, in which using lithium hydroxide, you can really replace the proton, this acidic proton, and we obtain this molecule. And what we have done is, to our surprise, we found a beautiful reversibility on this terephthalic acid, as indicated here, where you can see a potential of about 0.8 volt and a nice reversibility. And the same from what I will call the transmeconic acid. And these results are relatively important because you can see that now we have organic molecules that have the same capacity that are carbonaceous materials. But in addition, if you look at the redox potential, it's about 0.8 volts. And for battery manufacturers, this is very important because means, in this case, we are not obliged to use copper current collector. With this potential, we could use aluminum current collector. And more importantly, as I'm going to show you now, these materials present also some safety advantages against carbons. Indeed, what is very important in terms of safety when you're looking at lithium-ion batteries is directly the energy release by the reaction between the negative electrode and the electrolyte as a function of temperature. And the most elegant way to look at this is to perform DSC measurements in order to measure the heat release as a function of temperature. And what you are looking here is heat release when you are looking at a loaded carbon negative electrode, lithium-1C6, that I compare directly with our organic molecules. And you can see the value here. We have the heat release is 3 times less with this organic molecule than with carbon, which means that these organic molecules may present some advantages in terms of safety for the next generation of lithium-ion batteries. So this clearly indicates that we can do some redox chemistry with organic molecules. Now, of course, this considers the negative size of the battery. Now, we want to look, here's the question, can we make positive electrode using organic molecules? And this is, of course, what we have been trying to do, and you are going to see that the answer is yes. We have, in this case, decided to explore this type of compound, which I call this oxocarbon, which certainly has a verge of organic and inorganic chemistry, since it contains the carbon and mixed with oxygen. And it's interesting because it's certainly one of the oldest chemistry. Indeed, the potassium croconate was the first organic compound ever made by men back to the 18th century. So we look at this compound, and we try to work on this rhodizonate, dilithium rhodizonate. So we take, in this case, rhodizonic acid. We do again, I should simplify, but acidobasic reaction, in which we can replace the acidic proton by lithium. Then we do a dehydration, and we obtain this dilithium rhodizonate. And we look at the electrochemical performance of this compound, voltage versus composition. And what we found here is that we can nearly reversibly put in and release about 4 lithium that correspond nearly to the reduction of the different air carbonic groups. So this more or less is giving you an electrode of 580 mAh per gram. So of course, when you publish something like that, people tell you, yes, but you are working with organic, so you have a problem with density, and you will never benchmark with what has been done in the field of inorganics. And I'm going to show you that is not exactly true. Here, what you are looking now is the energy density as a function of rate, and what you are comparing is this type of new organic compounds versus our two-day electrode, lithium carbon oxide, lithium n phosphate. And you can see that in terms of C rate, by the way, C is a time for people who are not familiar with the field needed to discharge the battery in 1 hour. You can see in this case, this lithium-2C6SX compete nicely with today's electrode materials. Now, of course, if you look in terms of volumetric, here, of course, you see, more importantly, the effect of the energy density, where in this case, we compete nicely up to 1C with lithium and phosphate, but there, lithium carbon oxide is better. So, the message here is that with organic molecules, if you select nicely these organic molecules, you can definitively compete with some inorganic compounds. With advantages, and I'm going to move into this point, that now you provide the renewable aspect of the electrodes. Indeed, why? Let me go back to synthesis. So where this compound is made, lithium rhodizonate, is made directly from this myo-inositol. And now, if you look where this compound is coming from, you can see that myo-inositol can be directly obtained from this product that is phytic acid, and that is widely distributed in plants, and you can find it constitutes, as a matter of fact, 8% of the dry whey or corn steeping liquor. So means in this case, we can really make really these electron materials for what I will call sugar or carbohydrate that are very familiar, very common in nature. So means that now we can really make from biomass active electrons. So the question is now, people are going to tell you, what about the thermal stability? I'm going to show you also that these compounds behave nicely in terms of thermal stability. Indeed, we look again at the classical type of measurements. You didn't do TGA measurements. And what we find, very interesting as a matter of fact, that we have a weight loss at about 300 degrees C. So we have been studying this weight loss for quite a long time. And finally, we are able to understand what was going on. Here, we have simply a dismutation of the two molecules, rhodizonate, and two tetrahydroxyquinone, plus the three quinolic molecules that is very unstable and is going to decompose in CO and CO2. So that you end up with lithium-4 C6O6, which is tetrahydroxyquinone. As a matter of fact, in order to confirm this, we have synthesized this tetralithium tetrahydroxyquinone, as indicated here, by a simple, again, I should say, acidobasic reaction using lithium metoxide and methanol. And we obtain this compound. And what is very interesting is by doing this, we obtain suddenly the compound that has been the most stable about our organic material today. This is a compound that has been made at 200 degrees C, and you can see is nearly cyclability and very nice capacity retention, where in this case we have about 50 to 100 cycles. So this is more or less what we have been making. So now, of course, what are the drawbacks of this technology? We tried to make lithium ion cells by directly coupling a very oxidized lithium-2-6 with a very reduced materials, and this is more or less a curve that we obtain. We, in this case, we have high temperature stability, we have good cycle performances, but of course, you make a lithium ion cell, the energy density is relatively small due to the fact that you have small voltage output. So the main issue nowadays, and the challenge for you and for others, is the following one. We need to find high oxidation electrode material to be used as a lithium reservoir. Indeed, I don't know if you pay attention, but I use this compound lithium-2-C6O6, but unfortunately, as you can see here, I cannot do this reaction. Because if I do the reaction, in this case, the same thing if I use lithium carboxide, I oxidize, I have a decomposition of the materials. Now, our challenge is to find organic molecules loaded with lithium that I could oxidize. So this is more or less. But this is not an insurmountable task, and we have already some good result on it. And we are really convinced that in the next few years, this is only the weight some of the lithium ion batteries will be nearly assembled, means using electrodes coming nearly from the biomass and so on. So, in order to close up everything, I think now the next question that I would like to address in the last 5 minutes is, again, can we increase the capacity while ensuring sustainability and green storage? Because again, if you talk about electric application, this is more or less the energy delivered by a liter of gas. This is where we are in terms of lithium batteries. So we still have a large gap and large way to go in the factor of 50. So there are some potential technology, and here where we need to revisit some of the earlier lithium air or metal air systems. And we have type of research going on in this field. As a matter of fact, where I represent here the lithium air systems. And again, this is all technology that is resurfacing. Why? Because we have made progress at the nanomaterial scale, and now, using nanomaterials, we are able to directly make reversible lithium air electrodes. And as a matter of fact, this is more or less what we have been achieving, as a matter of fact, a slide that was given to me by Peter Booth, since we are working in collaboration on this project, where you can see that we can nearly, using lithium air system, achieve some reversibility. Of course, I put here only 3 or 4 cycles, because after 10 cycles, the reversibility is not here any longer. So again, here, you have directly a huge potential of these materials, since you can get here about 1,000 mAh per gram, which is about a factor 6 greater than what you can get as an insertion electrode. But here, I would like to be very careful and maybe send a message. There is a lot of excitement nowadays about lithium-air. But again, I can tell you, I've been working on these systems. There is also a huge amount of hurdles that need to be really faced. Number one, as a case of electrode optimization, porosity, protection against CO2 and H2O. And you need to realize that the system, finally, combine within the same device the two failures that we have for the last 25 years. And the fuel cells, we have been dwelling with oxygen electrode for quite a long time, and we don't completely master this electrode. As a negative electrode, we have been working with interface, lithium interface, lithium electrode interface, and we are still here wondering how to solve these issues. So I think this is a potential system, but it shouldn't be oversolded as I think it is by now. So, in order to conclude, I hope that I convinced you that by doing material chemistry, we have made huge amount of improvement toward developing eco-efficiency processes to make new phases. And I think along the road, we come out with new processes that are going to be important for all types of research field. I am showing you also that the field of organic chemistry and renewable electrode is also a very promising one, since we were able to find new, very attractive molecules. And if I would like really to conclude, say, in terms of research, I should say, you know, when you do research, never say never. Because more or less, you know, I told you, the phosphate and the silicates that we have been using, or we know in the structure for about 25 years, we have been disregarding the materials because they were poor electronic and ionic conductors. It turned out that 25 years from now, these are the most successful materials that ever exist. And believe me, there are still more coming. Now, the field of organic chemistry is certainly the same way. Organic electrodes have been around. The concept warrior, I think we've come out with new concept, and I won't be surprised that in 10 years from now, they will come back and certainly one of the more praised materials. So definitively, the lithium battery chemistry has never been so rich, and I can assure you there is more that will come out and you will see in the next few months. But to conclude, I cannot resist to give you my feelings of the future. This is more or less the way that I see the future in terms of battery development. This is more or less this conversion type electrode based on these nanomaterials. This is more or less what I see the organic, the cathode organics. You have lithium air. Here, we have lithium sulfur, even so I haven't talked too much about it. I think we'll certainly see lithium sulfur before lithium air. And also, something that I am really looking into it is the sodium ion chemistry. Again, here, everyone is driven by the business of lithium ion chemistry. You need to realize that there is an issue of the resource of lithium. And I think it is time to look at the sodium chemistry. Sodium and such compounds do exist. Unfortunately, we have been working not strong enough on this material. I know that there you have been working on some cathode materials, but no one so far, at least to my knowledge, look at the negative size to find some of these new materials. And I can assure you that there is some very interesting candidates here that can be used for all this stuff. But unfortunately, I may have deceived you, we are still far from the Moore law, and sorry for this, we are not good enough. But my peoples are better than me, and I want to thank them.
Thank you very much for a very stimulating talk. I trust that everybody heard him say that we should be expecting an announcement about a better positive active material in a few months. Are you willing to take some questions?
Yes, yes, definitely, yes. When you are at the 40 nanometer scale, in this case you have a single particles. And what is important here, you don't have directly a front phase. It's on wide difference between a 140 nanometer and a 40 nanometer. Now the question is it really the size that is important or the defects into the particles that can drive directly the single phase processes? But to answer your question, when you are at such nano size, you don't have directly two phases.
You told us very nicely about what you think about the electrodes of the future. Any predictions about the electrolyte?
You know, we just talked this morning about the electrolytes. There is a large amount of excitement about these ionic liquids. I think they are certainly interesting, but I never saw so far any exciting results in ionic liquids, neither at the positive electrode, neither at the negative electrodes. Now, there are some kind of research, definitively, on the different type of salts, where people want to replace lithium PF6. And there is some kind of large amount of work in our lab, as a matter of fact, by Michel Armand and by others in the world, on lithium TFSI, on lithium FSI, and new type of salts also that are we're going to bring to the market. But, in terms of electrolyte, I still see this liquid electrolyte. Even so, there are research going on in solid-state electrolyte by now to make solid-state battery and so on. But there, again, I say this is a long, far-reaching research.
I found it interesting that you had for 2015 the conversion cathode. I imagine that you're thinking of the fluoride compounds. Do you have any idea how we're going to overcome the problem of the hysteresis of the voltage when we go on discharge and charge to make them viable for a battery?
Two things, I would say. First, do we need to solve these polarization problems? If you look at the lithium air system that I mentioned here, you look at we have a 1 volt polarization, right? Now, you look at the fluoride system, we have about 0.7, 0.8. And here, again, I say you have some application for which this type of polarization is not a big issue. Now, again, if you are optimistic, look what we have done as a negative size. We have the same issue 4 years ago, where we are telling we could never solve the polarization issues on oxide and so on, iron oxide, cobalt oxide. And we come out with metal hydrides. And the metal hydrides, we come out with a conversion reaction, and we have only 200 millivolt of irreversibility. Unfortunately, these materials were great. For lower polarization, we cannot manage to have a good cycle life. Now, again, how we are going to solve the polarization issue on 3-volt materials, I don't have an answer.
All right, let's thank Professor Tarascon again.